Hello, trail travelers, overlanders, campers, people with workshops, garages, basements, anybody who's looking to do some heat. This is the video for you. We're going to answer the top 15 questions about diesel heaters. Let's get into it. Okay, first off, what is a diesel heater? Well, this is a diesel heater. This is from Vevor. This is a 5 kilowatt unit. And take the top off here so we can see the insides a little bit. So we have fuel tank, diesel heater. It's really a simple mechanism. There's a blower motor on the back that blows air over a diesel engine, which has a lot of fins, a big kind of a heat sink in there that exchanges the heat of the diesel engine into warm air, which then blows out the front. You have a controller on the front to set the power, to see error codes, things like that. There are some other features in this that we'll get into. And you have a fuel pump. This is really it. It is a super, super simple device. It just takes 12 volt power to run, and that's about it. Off the back here, it's got an exhaust and little air intake for the motor. So on the bottom, you'll see an air intake and exhaust for the motor, and the back has the air intake and the blower for the hot air. It is not blowing combusted air out. It is just hot air, which is the after effect of the diesel motor running. So that's a diesel heater. All right, let's get to our first question. Who are diesel heaters for? And I kind of said it in the intro, right? They're for people who have some space that needs heated, whether that be your basement, a garage, a workshop, a shed, a tent, a camper, a trailer, anything that you need heat for, a diesel heater is a great job. So it's not a single purpose, single design for one thing type situation. They have a lot of different uses. Now, when you saw that heat exchanger piece on the bottom, that you can buy just by itself and tie it into like the gas tank on your diesel truck or Sprinter or RV and just run it directly from your fuel tank and basically have unlimited heating. So we used to have one of these in our Sprinter, and now we have our rooftop tent. We needed a heating solution. So for us, a diesel heater made a lot of sense. So big question is, why diesel? Why not gas or propane or maybe something else? Well, as you can see, that system is very, very small. And a diesel engine is very simple to run. It just has a glow plug that once it gets hot, can basically keep a diesel motor running indefinitely with virtually no power. I mean, there has to be power because you have to have fuel going to it, so it requires a fuel pump. But as long as you're pumping fuel into a diesel engine, it's going to keep running. These tiny diesel engines are extremely quiet. I mean, there's no bang, bang, banging like you hear with a lawnmower engine. And that's the problem with gas. Gas engines are loud. They're a two-stroke system or a four-stroke system, and they're very, very loud. They're definitely not small. You can't get a gas engine that's the size of these diesel heaters. Secondly, a gas engine is way more complex. Now, if you think about it, there's a spark plug. So every time in the ignition sequence, the spark plug has to fire at the right point. That requires a way of igniting that, which is a coil or something, which requires a type of generator to be included. So there's a lot of components of a gas engine. Now, propane, on the other hand, is just very inefficient. There are propane versions of these heaters like this, but they burn through a ton of propane. Now, the other option is burning the propane directly inside your building or your tent or whatever, which you can do, but the byproduct of that is water vapor. So if you're in a tent, the whole inside of the tent is going to be covered with condensation. So that's not a good option either. Again, making the diesel heaters a very good choice. Now, if you've been looking at heaters lately or these options, you'll find that there are tons of these diesel heaters on the market. So why are there so many and why are they so inexpensive? Typically in the $100 range, maybe $125, $150. Some are a little bit more. There's even some in the $200, $300, $400 range. But why are they so inexpensive? Well, back in the early days, many years ago, I think in the 30s or 40s, where Bostow and Escher developed these diesel engines or these diesel heaters for use in things that had no heaters. That was buses and taxis and farm equipment, those type of applications that needed heat during the winter, but had no other way of running it, but also had a source of diesel fuel. So made it very convenient to make a diesel heater for those types of applications. Well, those patents ran out some time ago, and it just made it very easy for the companies over in China to replicate these diesel heaters and find a huge market for them. Having such a low barrier of entry being cost and making them very simple to operate, they got a really big hit product on their hands. So that's why we're seeing so many. The manufacturers over there can manufacture them extremely cheaply and put them out, and I'm surprised they can do it at this near $100 price point. So what are some things to look for when purchasing a diesel heater? Well, for me, I'd say there's kind of three main categories, or let's call it four, but we're going to touch on one of them individually, which is how to size it. What size should you get? So that's going to be the next actual question that we have. But I would say there's three things that make using one much easier. First is the controller that's on the front. There's older ones that really didn't have much in the way of features, and if you wanted to go and make an adjustment, you had to go to the device itself and make adjustments. That was very inconvenient, and you know, if you're up in a rooftop tent and you're having to change your temperature a few times during the night, it's a massive inconvenience. So the new ones, like this Vevor that I have, or some of the other new ones out there, they have remote controls, and they're included with it, give you very simple on, off, up and down control. So at a minimum, an absolute minimum, I would make sure that it has a remote control. However, most of the new ones actually have an app that can connect to the device via Bluetooth, make all the adjustments, see the status of the system. If there's errors, it'll tell you exactly what the error is. Instead of a E08, it'll tell you it's an overheating issue. So the app is way better for control as well as understanding what the system is doing. Now, if you go out and you're in the mountains, you're at higher altitudes, you also want to make sure you have one that has automatic altitude adjustment. In the past, you would have to adjust the fuel flow going in and setting the pulse rate and maybe look it up on a chart to figure out what you should be at based on the altitude that you're at, and could be a little hit or miss. The newer ones have barometers built in, so it makes it very easy. I just turn it on regardless whether I'm at sea level or I'm at 15,000 feet, this thing is going to work without me having to adjust anything. So automatic altitude adjustment is a big plus in my book. Okay, next big question is, what else do you need to buy in order to use one? And that's going to depend on a number of situations. If you're just buying the heating unit itself without the fuel tank and stuff, and you're going to mount it in a vehicle, what you're going to need is a whole different set of accessories and things to make that work. However, if you're buying an all-in-one unit like this for the same purpose as we are, which is camping and overlanding, putting it, you know, getting some air into our rooftop tent, well, that's a whole different issue. And let's talk about that. So the hose that comes with it is not going to reach our rooftop tent. It's going to fit on the front, put out some air. So now if this is in an RV or something, or under a bench where I can just direct this out, no problem. That's going to work just fine. But if we need to get up to the tent, we're going to need some hose. And so what I have is 16-foot insulated dryer hose. This is a 4-inch pipe. if you're going just, you know, a short distance, you're in a workshop, you just want to kind of direct the air, a 3-inch hose is going to work fine. If you're going directly into a tent on the ground, 3-inch hose is going to be just fine. If you're trying to push that air up 8-9 feet into a rooftop tent, a 3-inch hose is going to be way too restrictive and it's going to cause the system to overheat. Therefore, you're going to need a 4-inch hose. Now, we have this pretty simple put together. We have an adapter to go on here to go from the 3-inch to the 4-inch, and we stick the other end inside the tent. So we had a cost here of about $17 to get the hose, and you also need some way to power it. Well, when you get the system, it has the 12-volt leads on the back that are just bare wires coming out. So how do you power it? Well, in our case, we decided to put on a 12-volt plug. Pretty easy, just soldered it right on there. And then we use a Blue Eddy battery. This is the AC70, 768 watt hours. Super good for a platform like this. But we've also tested it with our Blue Eddy EB55, and it works just great. So you are gonna need 12-volt power. Again, if you're putting this in a fixed location inside of a building, well, then just get a 110 to 12-volt adapter so you can just run it indefinitely. Or if you're putting it into a vehicle, you can just run it directly up to 12 volts without any problems. If you're outdoors, you're camping, and you don't have any other power, you're going to need a battery. So there's that. Okay, so as I mentioned, one of the things you need to know is what size do you need? Now, you'll see ratings on these 2 kilowatt, 5 kilowatt, and 8 kilowatt. I just recommend getting a 5. I have not seen one single video that shows that an 8 kilowatt is any better than a 5 kilowatt. They seem to be not just functionally, but physically identical. There doesn't seem to be any difference between a 5 and an 8. I think that's, for the most part, marketing. Until someone can prove me wrong and actually show me an 8 kilowatt version that's putting out more power, then I just say, scratch the 8, get a 5. Now, why a 2? Well, sure, if you have a small tent, you know, or something where you don't need a lot of power, you don't need to, you know, you don't have a lot of space to try and heat, a 2 kilowatt might be fine. But given the price difference being literally in tens of dollars, $10-$20 difference between a 2 and a 5, why not just get a 5, right? And be done with it. Then if you ever need more heat, you have it on tap versus a 2, you might max out. What are some important things to know in order to use one? Well, the manuals tend to go over the first item here, which is the startup and shutdown process. Starting it up is pretty easy. You run power to it, you hit on, it's going to go, and then you can adjust the output level. What they don't really go into a lot of detail on some of them, and some they completely skip, is the shutdown process. Do not ever pull the power to it while it's running. You will gum it up, it will get all corroded with soot. You are going to have to tear the whole thing apart, clean it, and put it all back together again. Not an easy job. Big maintenance project. If you go and you just use the control in the front, the app, or the remote, and you hit off, and it tells you that it's turning off, you now have to wait until it shuts down. Now, depending on what temperature you are running at, that could be anywhere from 3 to 5 minutes, generally. It's going to cool down, it's going to burn off all the excess fuel that's inside the system, get the soot blown out, so you don't have to have a maintenance problem. So never, ever, ever just pull the plug on it. If that happens and you lose power, get it back on power as fast as you can and crank it to the highest setting and let it run for a few minutes to burn all that stuff out. Also, if you've been running it on like a 1 or 2 setting for a number of hours, like overnight in a tent, then you should bump it up to a 6, 7, or 8 for 5 or 10 minutes to just kind of burn it out and then shut it down properly. So that's my big tips for making sure you don't gum it up. The other thing that doesn't get talked about is diesel fuel gelling. Now, why are we taking these diesel heaters out with us when we're camping? Because we want to extend our camp season in and beyond the normal temperature ranges, right? We want to be in cold temperatures. We want to be up in the snow. We want to hit those trails early, be the first ones to lay track down in the snow. Well, that means it's cold. It can be really cold. And diesel fuel can typically start gelling up at around 15 degrees. So if you're not aware of that, this could be a big problem for you, because if the fuel gels up, it's going to stop running. You're not going to have any heat. And if that was the only thing you were relying on for heat, you're going to have a very, very bad evening. So if that's a problem, if you're going to be in these sub-15 degree temperatures, down to zero, down to minus temperatures, either make sure that the diesel fuel you have is rated for those temperatures, or you can mix it up to about 50-50 with kerosene, and that's going to lower that gelling temperature down to about minus 20. So there's options that you can do to prevent the gelling problem, but understand it can be a problem, and it has shut down heaters for a number of people on YouTube that have ended up having a very bad night and they didn't know why. So diesel fuel gelling at cold temperatures, keep that in mind. Our next question is, how much maintenance is involved? Well, honestly, if you take care of it right, and you run good fuel, maybe put a fuel filter on it, you shut it down properly every time, you boost that heat up right before you turn it off, all those things, these things can run for thousands of hours, easily, thousands of hours with no maintenance. There's not much to do. Now, only if you start seeing a bunch of smoke come out when you start it up every time, if you're seeing performance problems, if it's not running properly, or if it doesn't start up, now you have a maintenance issue, and it's probably going to require a teardown. And in most cases, it's probably cheaper to just replace the whole heating unit than it is to get someone to fix it if you can't do it yourself. If you can, great. If you can take apart a small motor, or if you can do some decent maintenance, you can work on these things. But the moment you have to give this to someone else to fix, it's going to be cheaper just to replace that unit. It's going to be in the $75, $80 range. So not much maintenance, which is really nice. Just take care of it, shut it down properly, and you'll be good to go. Oh, Jason asked this question, how much fuel do you need for a weekend? Well, that's a great question. And the short answer is, it depends, right? I like a lot of things. It's going to depend on your situation. What level do you need to run that heater at? Are you going to run it at 5 all night long? Are you going to run it at 2 all night long? Well, that's going to determine how much fuel you use. In most situations, you're going to be able to run it for 16 to 18 hours on a tank of fuel, which is about 1.3 gallons. So that's my general recommendation for if you have a full tank of fuel in it and you're only running it for, you know, those 8 hours at night when you're going to bed, two evenings pretty easily. So there's my answer. You can almost always run it without exception, unless you're running it at the highest levels, you can run it for two nights. This is a good question as well. Since we're putting these things outdoors for our tents, are they waterproof? Well, the short answer is yes and no, really. I mean, if you've ever mowed your lawn in the rain, you go, well, I guess my thing's waterproof. Yeah, I mean, technically it's not, but it will run in the rain. You know, same with the diesel heater. Will the heater run in the rain? Sure. The engine itself and all that is inside of a compartment that's inside of another compartment. Running in the rain isn't a problem. The problem is the controller on the front is not waterproof. So if you get rain or snow on the controller itself, you can end up having a bad day. Now, sure, you could wrap that, you could put it in a bag, there's ways of waterproofing the controller. So I'm not too concerned about that. What I'm probably going to do is 3D print a cover. So it just flips down over it, and when I need to get to that controller, which because I have the app and stuff is virtually never, then I can just pull that up, get to the controller, and hinge it back down. That's probably what I'm going to do, but I'm going to experiment with a few things and see. But the controller, that's the thing you have to be cognizant about that is not going to be waterproof. How much do they weigh? Well, they're going to vary a little bit based on the design, the case, the components that are in it, how they're set up. But this particular unit right there out of the box is about 24 pounds. So figure somewhere a pound or two in that category for an all-in-one unit, you're going to be in that 23 to 25 pound range. So not super heavy, but something to be aware of because it is going to add to your payload. All right, great question here. Do they have a thermostat? Can you just set this thing at 65 degrees and just let it go? Well, yes, you can, but the thermostat is on the controller. So you either have to have the controller inside the space that you're going to heat. Well, no, that's how you do it. You have to have the controller inside the space that you're going to heat, which means you either have to have the entire heater inside that space, or you need to splice in some extension wire so that you can move that controller inside your space. If you're in a workshop, a basement, a garage or something, and it's all you have it all properly vented to go outside with the exhaust, you can safely run this thing indoors, set a temperature on it, and let it go. If you're in a tent situation, roofed, especially a rooftop tent, you're not going to put this thing inside your tent. You're going to have it outside sitting somewhere with the hose running into your tent. In that case, if you don't splice some wire into that controller, there's no way to get that thermostat setting. However, there are two products on the market. I'm going to put them right here below. There's the afterburner controller, which is an expensive way of going, which is $100, and it replaces a handful of the electronics in the unit and gives you a wireless remote for the heater that also has a thermostat. Another option is the Burek remote control. This is an option that we might actually go for. It's basically not much bigger than the remote control that comes with it, has a screen on it, and you can set the temperature and a range for what you want it to run at, and it will emulate the remote control's commands to turn off and turn on the heater. Now, what it won't do is adjust the levels. So what you would do is you would go out, set the level on the device. Say, I want it at level 3, right? So you set level 3, and it's going to remember that when you power cycle it on and off. So using the Burek remote inside your tent or camper or whatever, you can set that for the remote to sense that temperature and cycle the heater on and off within a given range that you specify. It's a cheaper way of doing it. It's only about $50 for a wired one that you just plug into USB to run, and $70 for one that's got a battery in it that's rechargeable. And it's a good option. And maybe we'll use that, maybe we won't, but we're gonna see based on our experience if we can just set it on a specific level and just run it all night. By running it all night, we may use a little more fuel, but we'll use a lot less battery. The power draw on startup is pretty significant. It's about 125 watts. The running current draw is only about 15 watts. So it's better most of the time to run it continuously than to start and stop it a number of times. If it's only going to start up and start, you know, if you're only going to stop and restart it three times during the night, well, then it's not a big deal. You're going to burn a little bit of battery, but you're not going to kill your battery. If it's going to cycle 8 or 10 times during the night, you're going to probably run out of battery before you run out of fuel. So these things are cool and all, but you've got to weigh those pros and cons of whether having the fuel usage or the battery usage is a big deal. If this is inside and it's got a constant power source, then it's not a big deal. Let it power cycle all it wants. But when you're out camping and you're relying on something like a Blue Yeti battery, well, that power draw that could be a major issue with a controller like this. Another question, can you heat multiple tents with it? Well, sure. No, there's no reason why you couldn't. In fact, you can buy hose kits on Amazon that have a Y connector so you can connect two hoses to them. Now, in that case, I would probably stick with 3-inch hose. So either like this, if I've got two tents next to each other, I could run it like that, or the dryer hose like that, I could Y off and go to two rooftop tents. And again, I think 3-inch hose would be fine for that application because you're splitting it between two hoses, which is effectively going to give you a 6-inch hose. So you would be fine. But yes, you absolutely can heat two tents with it. Just get a Y splitter for the hose and you're good to go. Would I try and do more than that? Probably not, because at that point you're distributing so much of the airflow that the thing is just going to have to run constantly on a higher level, which means more noise, than you probably want. Two tents, pretty easy. I probably wouldn't go more than that. Let's get into some pros and cons of the diesel heaters. First, pro. Well, they're very efficient. They're very good on fuel. As I mentioned, two nights on about a gallon of fuel, that's not bad at all. If I was to run the engine in the Jeep, to sleep in the Jeep and keep it warm, probably going to use a quarter tank of gas. I mean, it's going to run for a long time, where the diesel heaters are very, very efficient. So they put out a lot of hot air for a little bit of fuel usage. The next pro is it's a dry heat versus a wet heat. Propane, as I mentioned, if you have a buddy heater or something like that inside your tent, the byproduct of that is water vapor. You're going to get water vapor inside. You're going to get condensation. You definitely don't want to run these inside of a camper where all that moisture is going to get into the walls and maybe that will give you mold and mildew issues, because it's just taking air and blowing it over something that is hot to create hot air. It's not adding any moisture to that air. And in fact, it's drying the air. So the air coming into your space is very, very dry. You do not have to worry about any condensation from running a diesel heater. So that is a big plus. Our next pro, you may debate me on this one a little bit, but I'm going to state that it's safer than using a propane heater. Hear me out. If you're using something like a buddy heater or the little heaters that go on top of the 1-pound tanks and all that, you have a few concerns, right? You have maybe a carbon monoxide concern. You have the condensation issue. And you have a burning issue should that tip over and light something on fire inside your tent. That could be a major problem. The fact that this diesel heater can be sitting a distance away from our tent, especially our trailer and our rooftop tent, there's really no danger of this thing going up in flames and catching everything on fire. A diesel fuel is not explosive, so if it spills and there's a spark, it's not going to go up. It takes compression and heat to get diesel fuel to ignite. So I'm going to call it being safer than propane or gasoline, for that matter. Not that you'd want a gasoline heater, because it would be loud and obnoxious. Fourth pro that I'm going to mention, they're cheap. I mean, you can buy these brand spanking new for about $100. Now, I'm going to say you're going to want to spend a little bit more so you get some of the extra accessories like the remote control and things. You want to make sure you get one with Bluetooth, the altitude adjustment. So you're right now, the low end is going to be around $125, and you're going to see units that go up to about $200 or so, just based on the cases that they're in, the layouts they're in, and all that. So between $125 and about $220 is going to be the price range for these things to make sure you get one. But for something that can last you many, many years, thousands of hours of output, provide you a nice dry heat, yeah, I think it's worth it. Okay, one of the cons. Well, there's noise, right? Now, when you buy this thing right out of the box, it's not going to be a fun experience if you're out camping in the woods and it is just dead quiet. You're going to have the sound of the blower that's going, but worse, you're going to have this tick, tick, tick sound from the fuel pump. Well, I do have a video coming that is going to show you how we made ours ultra quiet. You cannot hear that fuel pump. You're still going to hear the blower, which is not that bad. It's more of a white noise, but the ticking we have completely eliminated. So stay tuned for that video. But the noise is definitely an issue, and that's something that you just have to see how it goes. For us, I have to sleep with a CPAP machine in our tent, so there's always a fan going when we're sleeping. So I don't think this is going to be that obnoxious. We're going to have it on a real low setting, probably not going to bother us at all. So something to be aware of. And if noise is a major issue for you, yeah, it could be a big concern. Another big con, it's another fuel to carry for most people. Now for us, we have a gas Jeep, so we have to carry gasoline. We have a propane cooking system. We have to carry propane. Now we have a diesel heater. So it's a third source of fuel that we have to carry. Now, fortunately, I found a nice way of mounting it on our trailer, so it's not that big of a deal. It's very compact. We carry an extra gallon on the trailer plus a gallon inside of there. We can go probably 4 or 5 nights without any problem having to run it every night. So we've got plenty of fuel, but it is yet another fuel to carry, which again takes up space and everything else. So something to be aware of. Well, another con for sure, it's one more thing to set up and tear down, right? You're busy, you're setting up your tent, you're setting up the cooking space, you're setting up tables, you're setting up chairs. Well, now you have to set up the diesel heater. It doesn't take that long. For us, the way we've got it set up, we can pull it out, we plug it into the 12-volt power, we have the hose in a bag, we plug it in, we run it up to the tent, we're done. It takes 1 or 2 minutes to get it up and running, not a big deal. But again, you got to tear it down, you got to pack it all up, you got to put it all away, and you have to make space for it. So it's one more thing to carry, one more thing to set up and tear down. So, final, are they worth it, right? Well, I can't answer that for you. Is it worth it? Well, they're inexpensive. They allow you to be outside camping later in the season, start earlier in the season. For people who have basements, workshops, sheds, and things like that, you want a very efficient way of heating that without having to burn through a lot of electricity, because heating with electricity is ridiculously expensive. Running some other fuel source in there, you know, having to deal with propane heaters, you can put a diesel heater in very easily. For the people who have campers or sprinters or that type of thing, adding a diesel heater, great idea, because it's going to be way more efficient than the heater that's running off the engine and do a really good job. So for a lot of people, a diesel heater is totally going to be worth it. For others, it might not be. If you're a camper, overlander, and you don't plan on going out when it's below 30 degrees or below 40 degrees, you don't need a heater. Pretty simple. We haven't needed one for 2 years. We want to do some colder weather stuff. It was time to get a heater. So for us, we believe it's going to be worth it. For you, I can't say. You have to decide that for yourself. So thanks for watching, everybody. I know this has been a big, long video, but I hope I answered a lot of questions about diesel heaters. I hope it was informative. If so, if you got anything out of this video, we really appreciate it. If you like and subscribe to the video, really makes a big difference to the YouTube algorithm, helps other people find the content. If you want to support us, you can hit join underneath the video on most mobile apps or with on the website. Underneath, there's a join. A couple bucks a month helps support us, gets us out there, gets us creating more content. It just pays for the gas. So we really appreciate the people who support us there. Thanks for watching, everybody. From Katarina and myself, stay safe out there. We'll see you on the trails.